Christian Audio presents In Over Your Head, Creating Balance and Finding Peace in the Busy by Susie Larson, narrated by Sarah Zimmerman. How to use this book. Look back over seasons when you found yourself feeling irritable, frustrated, tired, and out of whack. Consider that maybe, a little at a time, you let go of what you knew was good for you, and you filled your time with what cost you but didn't nourish you for the long run. I've learned that if we're willing to put even a few hours a week into our physical and spiritual health, that discipline will carry us a long way, and we'll walk in an accumulative strength as a result. When we live a hit-and-miss lifestyle with something so important as our physical and spiritual health, we'll never quite hit our stride or enjoy the kind of life rhythm God has for us. If you're ready to incorporate some healthy habits with dividends, let's do this. Remember, you don't have to apply every idea in this book. I suggest you don't. Instead, as you prayerfully work through its chapters, trust God to quicken your heart and speak to you about your next right choices. Ask Him to give you the grace and the want to stick with healthy habits and make them a normal part of your life. The amazing thing is, you could listen to this book again next year, be in a whole new place, and realize you're ready for more healthy habits. Give yourself grace, but also be willing to give yourself a little push. You know what you can handle, and Jesus cares deeply for you. He'll be with you every step of the way. Each chapter concludes with the following components: prayer, to encourage you; steps toward health. Say these out loud, because faith comes by hearing. See Romans chapter 10, verse 17. And when you hear yourself declare these truths and healthy determinations, it'll play a part in changing your mindset and gaining a whole new momentum. Try this. Here you'll find advice on some potential next steps. Pick the ones that resonate with you and will work for you. Balance application. This section summarizes the chapter, boiling it down for you. Hopefully, these truths will begin to make a deep impact on your soul. Study time. For those who want to take a deeper dive into Scripture, I've provided a handful of verses to look up and some questions to ponder. You'll need a journal or a notebook for this exercise. Note, it'd be great if you wrote down some of your goals and expectations at the front of the journal and kept them before you daily. Remember, this isn't a fad diet or a once-and-done sort of thing. This is all about a lifestyle change so you can last long and finish strong. Personal reflection. I'd love to see you commit to working your way through these questions. I ask you to do some real soul-searching, and I think you're ready for it. Your journal is a great place to record your thoughts, prayers, and answers to these questions. This week's goal. Use this section to write down even the simplest goal. For example, my goal is to quit the negative, berating self-talk. Or my goal is to quit eating sweets during the week. You get the idea. On one hand, be kind to yourself. Don't set impossible goals and then beat yourself up for falling short. But on the other hand, remember that growth and forward progress always costs us something. Be willing to ask something of yourself. God is working in you, helping you to do what's good and right and true. God's promise to me. This section is also optional, but I think it's an important, powerful exercise. Based on your overall personal goals, or even your goal for that week, find a Bible promise to pray about and memorize. For instance, if you're constantly tempted to eat more than you should, write down 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, and own that promise. I've made the most strides in my Christian journey through knowing, praying, and standing on the promises of God. See this journey not as an obligation to shape up, but as an invitation to step up. I'll be praying for you, and I'm proud of you. Do you ever wonder? I wonder why we wander from what nourishes our souls. We wander from healthy eating, right thinking, and time with God. We wander from faithful friends, quality time, and the challenge to grow deeper. We lose the fight for what's best for us when we don't fight at all. Somehow, for some reason, our steps take us from our appointed road toward a less than best path for us. Do we really enjoy living a peripheral life? I don't think so. Is it easier? Perhaps it's more convenient, but I don't think it's easier. Living a life of second bests and stuck places wears on our soul and steals our joy. On the other hand, in the moments when things line up for us, when we are doing what we care about, passion emerges and joy returns. We find ourselves wondering, why did I ever let this go? And yet we do let it go, over and over again. Is it that we don't care enough? I think we care a lot. But our priorities get skewed because we live in a fallen world where the currents of sin and defeat are strong, and if not resisted, will pull us under. That's when we feel in over our head, and that's when we feel at the mercy of our crazy lives. As long as we walk this earth, we will contend with the current. But this shouldn't shake us, because God has made a way for us. We're not at the mercy of our schedules, our culture, or even our weaknesses. We're in the mercy of God, which eclipses every lesser thing around us. Even our weaknesses become a thing of beauty and strength when we're hidden in Christ Jesus. God is immovable. We are the ones who move. God is consistent. We have our moments. God is powerful. We are powerless without Him. All His thoughts are pure and holy. Ours can be selfish and small. We need Jesus. Just as we need oxygen to breathe, we continually need Jesus' input, His breath, and His Spirit in and through us. He is our source. We must stay close to the source. Given that backdrop, how are you today? Listen through to the following questions. 1. Do you wish you had more energy? 2. Do you lack focus, passion, and direction? 3. Do you feel at the mercy of your schedule? Is life pulling you in too many directions? 4. Does the term spiritual health make you think of rigid rules and an unmaintainable level of holiness? 5. Would you like to be more physically fit? 6. Would you like to enjoy a greater awareness of God's love for you? If you answered yes to any of these questions, join me as we explore the wonder of our physical and spiritual health. God has divinely woven them together. You must know at the outset that you are loved and accepted right where you are. But if you are interested, God has more for you. If you're tired of half-hearted living, this book can help. Get ready to take a fearless inventory of your habits and choices. As you read, ask God to lead you out of the swirling current of imbalance to a place of stability and strength in both your physical and spiritual life. You begin to feel relieved as you find yourself off the hook from having to achieve a certain picture of perfection. On the other hand, you'll feel back on the hook as you are challenged in every circumstance to find the most fruitful place amid your life's current season. This book has two parts, physical health and spiritual health, and both will deal with essential components of health and holiness. At the end of each chapter, you'll find study and reflection questions for both individual and group use. Take your time and pray through every chapter. Allow God to speak to you, deal with you, heal you, and set you free to powerfully affect the world around you. When you are at your best, the world around you is blessed. My prayer is that as you listen, you'll accept God's forgiveness and leave your past behind. May you trust Jesus with your future so you'll be fully alive in the present moment. May your soul be awakened to all you have in Him today. May you be a living, breathing example of Christ's love for a lost world, so when others encounter you, they encounter Him. Bless the day, my sister. Susie Larson. Part 1. Physical Health. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 27 says, "I discipline my body like an athlete, training it to do what it should. Otherwise, I fear that after preaching to others, I myself might be disqualified." Chapter 1. How did I get here? Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 through 30 say, "Then Jesus said, 'Come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you, because I am humble and gentle at heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy to bear, and the burden I give you is light." My good intentions had gotten the best of me. I said yes to far too many opportunities, and now I was paying a costly price. I had no room in my life for red lights, wide load trucks, or leaky dishwashers. Every minute had its place in my day, as I whipped from one task to another, checking them off my list upon completion. As my car sped around a bend, I chomped on a dry bagel. The trees went by in a blur. The thought, "savor the flavor," crossed my mind, but I waved it away as though it were a gnat circling my head. I made it to the bank, the library, and then reached the restaurant just in time for my lunch appointment. How did I end up on this fast track again? Where did that place of peace go? I shoveled down a salad as I listened intently to my friend. Savor. There it was again. My friend and I shared a wonderful time, but it was over before I knew it. A glance at my watch reminded me I still had 3 stops to make before heading home in time to meet the kids as they got off the bus. My friend and I embraced and promised not to let so much time pass before we met again. The gurgle sounds coming from my stomach made me realize that perhaps I had eaten a bit too fast. Savor the flavor. I marched out to my car and got behind the wheel. I turned the key, revved the engine, and then took my foot off the gas pedal. I listened to the steady hum of the motor and marveled at the irony. The engine didn't drive itself. I was the one with the lead foot. And nobody pushed me to keep such a fast pace in my life. My own drive pushed me. I paused and prayed, "What is it you're trying to tell me, Lord?" I sensed His whisper in return, "You are living in the next moment and missing the present one. You are so focused on your destination that you're simply consumed with getting there. Did you happen to notice the beautiful sky I painted this morning? How about the trees? Did you notice how the treetops were blanketed with fresh snow? Take your salad today. You were so busy stabbing your next bite that you were totally unaware of the great morsel of food you already had in your mouth. That taste was history before it ever hit your lips. Wouldn't it be wonderful to savor the flavor of the bite in your mouth? Be thankful for the abundance of food in front of you and take a moment to enjoy it. You're missing so much of the journey because your mind is on the destination." I wasn't sure how long I sat there, but it didn't matter. My life needed some tweaking, and Jesus had just spiritually adjusted me. My life had subtly shifted out of whack to the point that I'd completely overlooked the significant gifts He'd sent my way throughout the day. I decided my other errands could wait, and I headed home. On the way, I pulled back on the gas pedal and slowed way down as I rounded that same bend. I looked at the lofty pines that pointed to the heavens. I even put the window down several inches just to breathe in the crisp winter air. Thank you, Jesus, for this beautiful day. I arrived home in time to see my kids get off the bus. Instead of rushing to get that one extra load of dishes done before they burst through the door, I went to the living room window and watched them as they hoofed through the deep snow with rosy cheeks and thick winter garb. They lobbed a few snowballs across the street to their neighbor buddies and then ducked behind a snow mound to dodge returning fire. They grow up so fast. I breathed a prayer. Help me to make the best of these days, Lord. Help me not to race through each one. I want to see the miracles in front of me. May I remember that each day is a special gift, wrapped in a supernatural bow. Oh, and by the way, thank you for that beautiful sky. It's going to be a glorious sunset. As I watched my kids make their way to the front door, my mind wandered back to a tougher time in our lives. We were on the cancer floor of the hospital with our little boy. He was having night sweats and had a large lump on his neck. We watched as they wheeled him away for various tests, but something was different during this trial. Because of the many crises we'd endured in previous years, we finally believed God to be who He said He was. We truly knew God was for us. See Romans chapter 8, verse 31. We could take Him at His word, and we did. Even though we were nervous and on edge, we had an inner peace and stability. We also had many people praying for us, visiting us, and taking care of our household duties. We received great blessings from family, our church, and the hospital. I felt so cared for that even in the middle of our crisis, I had something to give away. I sat in a large rocking chair and watched all the precious, hairless children welcome my child into the fold. I found myself asking, "What does obedience look like here, Lord? How can I love, serve, and obey you in this setting?" The Lord whispered to my heart, "Watch the other moms and dads. Look at the fatigue in their eyes and pray for them. They live this every day. Listen to them and help to carry their load." I looked around at some of the world's greatest unsung heroes. Life moves so fast. We have appointments, luncheons, hockey games, videos, late fees. Highways, skyways, hallways, and my way. Here, it was just the opposite. Aches, pains, prayers, tears, hallways, dark ways, lost ways, slow days, and not my way. Wow. Nobody looked polished around here. They looked tired and weary. They didn't seem to notice, because this was not their focus. Their children were. I lost track of time as they shared their stories. I was thankful to have the opportunity to pray for a weary grandmother and grateful to receive comfort from her as well. I had an underlying strength that held fast. This was a powerful revelation to me. I found the eye of the storm, the axis, in a very stressful situation. I saw myself fully as a child of God. I was under His care, but I was also under His charge. And since I had strength to give, He provided the opportunity to serve. Somehow, I had found my place of balance in that crisis. Thankfully, our son didn't have cancer. And yet here in this place and time, watching my healthy boys get off the bus, I realized that by overcommitting myself, I gave too much away, and with it, my sense of wonder. God called me back once again to find my peace with Him in the season I was in. Balance is more than skin deep. Now, granted, in times of crisis, we need to receive far more than we're capable of giving. We also experience times of strength and grace when we can give much more than we're receiving. But we cannot for too long give at the expense of receiving without losing our health and perspective. And we must never let go of the fact that we are living, breathing creatures made for a heavenly kingdom. God always provides nourishment for our souls. He also sets up many divine appointments where we can offer a blessing. And he paints many beautiful skies that call us to lie down and look up. True balance isn't defined by the appearance of having it all together. Some of the most together-looking women are the most out of balance, at least from a heavenly point of view. In the worldly sense, self-realization and self-ambition have become celebrated idols. Promoting ourselves, our gifts, and our abilities is an expected and acceptable road in the secular arena. But as women of faith who love our Savior, we are called to a much different path. He is the point. He is the one who gets the credit. And He is the one we serve. The irony is that as we embrace the God-given components of a healthy life, we will look more put together. We will have more together. But this won't be our highest aim, because we know better than anyone how quickly life can change. Our goal and our aim is to pursue the mindset that we are alive in Christ. He wants to breathe life into us so we can serve Him by living a healthy, holy, and abundant life. Scripture promises we will encounter trials and troubles, yet we are also promised access to the very power that raised Christ from the dead. See Ephesians chapter 1, verses 19 through 20. Since Christ has paid for and provided for every scenario, we have all we need to embrace life with a sense of purpose, power, and balance. This kind of balance goes with us and adjusts to the places God takes us and to whatever He allows to happen in our lives. Balance is worth pursuing. Where are you right now? It doesn't matter if your road is rough or smooth. There is balance to be found and greater health to be realized. Even in the valley, there is higher ground, the place of greatest fruitfulness, and it is that place we seek in every situation. As we move along in our journey toward balance, you will receive practical tips to help you both physically and spiritually. You will be challenged to go just a bit further than you may feel like going. If you apply the principles in this book, you will get healthier. But more importantly, you will begin to see yourself as Christ sees you. Your perspective will change. Your tastes will change. And before you know it, you'll lose your taste for what weakens you. And you'll more consistently hunger and thirst for what nourishes you, both physically and spiritually. I pray this book will help you find your place with Jesus no matter where life finds you. Father God, You have done so much for me, and I thank You with all my heart. I don't know why I sometimes choose the less than best path when I know there is a better way. Motivate me to start anew today. Help me to find my way to the peace You provide. I want to take what You have given and give You a great return on Your investment. Create in me an excitement to live a healthier life. I love You. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray. Amen. Steps toward health. If my life is currently caught in the swirling current, I will come before God today and find my place of peace with Him. I will ask Him to show me what needs to go from my schedule. If my life is currently a peaceful, balanced place, I will thank God today for blessing me in this way. I will ask the Lord to show me practical ways to guard the balance I'm enjoying right now while looking for opportunities to stretch, grow, and be a blessing to the world around me. I will be mindful of the fine line between a healthy protection of my balance and a selfish protection of my personal comforts. I will ask the Lord to heighten my conviction so I will instantly notice when I begin to approach the selfish line. I will ask the Lord to prepare me to take this journey toward health and holiness. I will stand in faith, knowing He will come through for me. I will prayerfully consider the idea that God has someone in mind right now, someone with whom I'm supposed to take this journey, someone I can bless and encourage, and who will do the same for me. Try this. If you feel hopelessly overcommitted while looking at this month's calendar, sit down and pray. Ask the Lord to show you what can be rescheduled or taken off your schedule. Make the phone calls and the necessary adjustments. Look at your calendar and X off a day or two each week when you plan not to have plans, especially those days that fall right before or right after an event or a commitment that may deplete you. Write down a list of 5 high-priority items you want to accomplish this month. For example, go on a date with your child, catch up on paperwork, visit a grandparent. Post that short list next to your monthly calendar. When you receive calls and requests for commitments, measure those requests against what you felt convicted to accomplish at the beginning of your month. Guard your time and accomplish what you know you should. Balance application. If life is too busy, make the adjustments necessary to find your place of peace again. If you are in a crisis, whether or not it feels natural, seek after God and find your place with Him so you are not swept away with your fears. Some crises are so intense that the Lord Himself carries us through without any pressing in on our part. If you are on a smooth path, guard it and look for ways to be a blessing to others. Study time. 1. Read Ruth chapter 2, verses 8 through 22. 2. Do you see a parallel between Boaz's care for Ruth and your Heavenly Father's care for you? Explain. 3. In what tangible ways did Boaz equip and care for Ruth? 4. Why was it important for Ruth to stay within the boundaries set for her? 5. Why is it important for you to do the same? 6. Ruth was a woman of honor, diligence, humility, and gratitude. In what ways do you see God establishing these virtues in you? 7. Pause and pray. Ask the Lord to draw you closer to Him. Personal reflection. 1. In what ways have you missed God's provision and goodness because of your current pace? Write out a prayer and express your thoughts to Him. 2. Someone once asked, "If I woke up tomorrow with only what I thanked God for today, what would I still possess?" Spend some extended time surveying your life and count every blessing you'd miss tomorrow if it went away. 3. Given the current immovables in your life, what you cannot change, what would a life of rhythm and balance look like for you? Spend some time with Jesus. Ask Him for a fresh vision for this season of life and for wisdom and clarity around your next steps. This week's goal, fill in the blank. God's promise to me, fill in the blank. What keeps you balanced, grounded? Heather wrote, "I think when it comes to balancing out my life, I found that I need to go to the living water that gives life first. I need to stop the comparison game, and I need to listen to God's calling on my life. Because when I listen to God and hear Him speak, then He is the one who balances out all the details. Life can be a beautiful, messy balance, but God loves when the mess is blessed by Him." Chapter 2. What balance isn't? Philippians chapter 1, verse 6 says, There has never been the slightest doubt in my mind that the God who started this great work in you would keep at it and bring it to a flourishing finish on the very day Christ Jesus appears. I tried to rest, but I couldn't. The pain kept me from falling into a deep sleep. I looked once more at the needle pokes up and down my arms and sighed. My veins kept collapsing, requiring new sites for the IV. I stared at the plastic cylinder embedded in my arm. Attached to it was a long tube that reached up to a bag of medicine, which hung on the mini blinds behind the couch. This medicine was a mixed bag of blessings and curses. On the one hand, the fluid offered my only hope for recovery. On the other hand, it cost us a fortune, which forced us deeper into debt. The medicine made me sick, weak, and tired, but it was also supposed to make me better, to give me back my life. Whenever I think back to that time when I was battling Lyme disease, I remember clearly how the battle affected me on several fronts, physically, spiritually, and emotionally. Vertigo, joint pain, scary neurological symptoms, and mind-bending fatigue had their way with me. The enemy also seemed to have unhindered access to me. I later learned he's on a short leash, but it certainly didn't feel true then. Fear, anxiety, and worry confronted me daily. Our finances seemed broken beyond repair, and my 20-something body felt the same way. My life never looked as imbalanced as it did back then. Rather than teaching group fitness classes, my extra exertion came in the form of taking a shower once a week. More than that, it drained from me any energy I possessed. Our house needed repair, our debt took on a life of its own, and our friends wearied themselves as they chipped in to care for our three little boys because I was too sick to do so. So yes, when I look back, I remember what a tough season that was for us. But I'm also thankful for the treasures I gained. In that terrible valley, I learned surrender, brokenness, and trust. I had to reckon with the promise I'd made long ago when I gave my life to Jesus. Was I serious about my commitment to him when it seemed he was answering none of my prayers? After many sleepless nights, fist-pounding laments, and fear-filled tears, I decided I was serious about my heart's cry for more of him and less of me. The hardest part for me was my inability to produce anything. In fact, just the opposite occurred. I was costing money, time, resources, and energy, and I could do nothing about it. For a doer, this was a nightmare come true, and yet only in my depletion could I have found God to be my everything. As I faced the black hole of insecurity that hid beneath all my efforts, I found that God's love fills every empty place when we're not filling them with something else. He is the source of identity, of hope, and of life itself. Had I not plummeted to the depths of despair and sickness, I would not have been able to grasp the scope of his love and care for his people. We live in a society that measures value by what we produce and how many titles we claim. But we cannot and must not allow such a shallow measure to define what God has created. Although from the outside I looked as though I was wasting away, costing much, contributing little, that valley provided my life's highest education. Because God went to great lengths to create anew something that has never been done before, nor ever will be again, you must let Him decide your worth. He knows best how you are wired, so allow Him to become your point of reference, the filter through which you run every thought, every circumstance, and every opportunity, every fear, insecurity and worry, every season, every storm, and every blessing. We were made by Him and for Him. You can trust Him to establish you. We'll look at this in depth later. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 15 says, "Our lives are a Christ-like fragrance rising up to God, but this fragrance is perceived differently by those who are being saved and by those who are perishing." We measure our lives by a different standard because our highest goal is not to be admired and accepted by the world, but to live free and full lives that honor God and bless others. Before we can maintain a godly balance in our lives, we must first define what balance isn't. Balance is not a put-together appearance. Women who appear extremely put together can sometimes be the most imbalanced persons. When emphasis is placed on perfecting outward presentation, it can be at the expense of true personal growth. Women who work too hard to appear perfectly together tell me they do so because another area in their lives feels completely out of control. Some women, however, just have a knack for keeping it all together. God bless them. I sometimes think one reason they were put on this earth is to keep the rest of us humbly dependent on Jesus. There is a wonderful consolation here, though. As you pursue a life of godly balance and health, you will look more together and you will have more together. But this should not be our goal. Being fully alive in Christ is our goal. As we gain ground, both physically and spiritually, we will hold what we love with an open hand, fully trusting Jesus' work in our lives. The pursuit of God with a posture of trust keeps us positioned and prepared for all that comes our way. Balance is not a perfectly managed schedule. We can't get around the need for calendars, smartphones, and list apps. Because of our multifaceted life, we need to stay on top of our tasks and commitments, lest we be completely overwhelmed by the rat race culture of our day. And the truth is, some women are just good at this stuff. They are punctual, perfect managers of their appointments, arrivals, and departures. And there's great virtue in being organized and prompt. I once heard someone say, being late is a form of selfishness. I'm basically saying I care more about my schedule than I do about yours. Ouch. Very true. To be frantic, harried, and forgetful of where we are supposed to be and when we're supposed to be there certainly undermines our witness. However, balance is not simply a perfectly managed schedule. In fact, some of the best schedule managers I have ever seen forget about little things, like, say, people. Far too many people spend more time with their smartphones than the people right in front of them. How many sunsets, smiles, and tasty morsels have we missed because we're mindlessly swiping through our phones? When it is all said and done, people and God are what will last. And if we spend our days serving and mastering our schedules, we'll miss the needs of those around us. When this happens, we lose, and those we were appointed to touch lose as well. While managing our schedules is a component to balance, true balance also has a flexibility and adaptability to it. True balance makes the plan, but allows the Lord to determine the steps. See Proverbs chapter 16, verse 9. Moreover, as you begin to maintain balance, your schedule will feel more doable and you will have more margin in your life. Balance is not a life free of conflict and difficulty. Consider the enormous difference between the peacekeeper and the peacemaker. The peacekeeper works tirelessly to avoid conflict and preserve the appearance that all is well, no conflict here. The peacemaker is determined to have true inner peace and will therefore live from the truth and deal openly and honestly with conflict. James chapter 3, verses 17 through 18 says, "The wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure. It is also peace-loving, gentle at all times, and willing to yield to others. It is full of mercy and the fruit of good deeds. It shows no favoritism and is always sincere. And those who are peacemakers will plant seeds of peace and reap a harvest of righteousness." A life of balance pursues a heart of peace. Though we bear God's image and Jesus forgives us of our sin, we still sin. We're still selfish, and we still forget to love others the way Jesus has loved us. And since that's just true, there will be conflict. The question is, will you come through your relational breakdowns more pure, holy, and forgiving? Or will you harbor bitterness and poison your soul? A truly balanced woman will face conflict with dignity, security, humility, and love. To keep balance and perspective in all seasons, we must dispel the idea that we're supposed to be on in every situation. Thank the Lord, He's much more merciful than that. And yet His provision is so abundant that He, being on all the time, will powerfully work through us, even in our lowest of times. Balance is not summed up by the picture of what is happening on the outside. It is dictated by the truth transforming us on the inside. Thank you, Jesus. Precious Lord, You are all I need. You are my strength and my portion. Help me, Lord, not to look to the latest fad or fashion to determine my worth. May I never judge my value by what I produce. Help me instead to see from Your perspective. As I embrace Your values and make them my own, I will begin to change from the inside out. Give me a clearer picture of what balance looks like for me in this season I'm in. Help me not to compare and then despair. Help me instead to fix my eyes on You. I need You every hour. Amen. Steps toward health. If I am currently in a valley, I will resist the temptation to compare myself with those who are not. I will say, okay, I can't do fill in the blank, but I can do fill in the blank. If I am currently in a place of peace and plenty, I will resist the temptation to think that life is good because I am good. Life is good because God is good. And I will use my strength to help someone who needs a hand. If necessary, I will change my thinking in regard to what a successful day looks like. I will try to be open and flexible toward the changing needs of each new day. Try this. Write down the 5 things you value most in this world. Do your time investments reflect your values? Spend some extra time this week in prayer. Ask the Lord to give you a sense of what He is working on in you. Write it down, tuck it in your Bible, and continually pray about it until you see maturity in that area. Take a personal inventory of your motivations. Are you consistently doing or pursuing anything so others will think, fill in the blank? Ask the Lord to help you step away from this pursuit and allow that empty place to be filled by Him. Meditate this week on the fact that God loves you just for who you are and not for what you've accomplished. Allow yourself to be filled with joy at the thought. Once you've taken hold of this truth, don't let it get away from you. Balance application. To some degree, we're all products of our environment. And yet, as Francis Frangipan, author and pastor, once said, we must determine to allow nothing and no one to shape us, not even our personal experiences, unless they are consistent with the promises of God. To live within the promises of God, we must guard our hearts from the poisons of bitterness and jealousy. To maintain true balance, we must honestly assess our circumstance and then look for and find the place of greatest fruitfulness. This is how we gain ground even in the deepest valleys. Study time. 1. Think about Ruth again. She was a widow in a foreign land who worked long hours under the sun to help provide for her mother-in-law and herself. Ruth did not have an easy life, but she truly was a woman of honor. Read Ruth chapter 4, verses 13 through 17. 2. Describe in your own words Ruth's struggles and the outcome. 3. How often do you notice God making something magnificent out of something menial? Write down or discuss other times you've seen this happen in the Bible and in modern-day life. 4. Where are you in your own process? For example, waiting, working, reaping. 5. How is your attitude in relation to where you are right now? If you're struggling, be honest about it. Ask for prayer and allow God to speak to your heart. 6. To give a sacrifice of praise is to thank and worship God even when it is difficult to do. The sacrifice of praise puts feelings aside and hangs on to faith instead. Giving God the thanks he deserves will sometimes cost us something. Pause and thank him by faith for his promise to meet all your needs. He is still faithful, and he will make something beautiful of your life if you let him. Personal reflection. 1. In what ways have you compared and then despaired? What does that person have that you so long for? Spend some time with Jesus and ask him for a more accurate picture of her life and yours. May you pray today with a fresh perspective. 2. When it comes to others' opinions and how you present to a watching world, what area of your life has too much of a hold on you? For example, fashion, weight, finances, intellect, social acquaintances. Write out a prayer of surrender. Put God in his rightful place in your life. May his opinion and perspective matter most of all. Our lives are meant to be a shining light in a dark world. And of course, it matters how we present to a watching world. But most of us know the difference between a desire for others to know the love of Jesus and the desperate need for others to approve of us. 3. Consider your answer to the prior question and, as an act of faith, loosen your grip on what has occupied too much space in your life. Offer it to Jesus and ask him to show you what faith and freedom look like instead. Engage your faith, walk in holy confidence, and determine that Jesus alone is enough for you. This is an important step to freedom. This week's goal, fill in the blank. God's promise to me, fill in the blank. What keeps you balanced, grounded? Jane wrote, "I seem to be able to recognize when I'm out of balance. I get alone with God as quick as I can, with my Bible, my journal, my gratitude notebook, sometimes at the beach or the library or my dining room table, but I stay there until I hear from my Father and I feel the peace that passes all understanding. That's how I know I'm back in balance." Chapter 3. What Balance Is. John chapter 9, verse 4 says, "All of us must quickly carry out the tasks assigned us by the one who sent me, for there is little time left before the night falls and all work comes to an end." When I think back to the times I was most out of balance, both physically and spiritually, I shudder. That was when I was most depleted and distracted. More than 30 years ago, I carried 35 extra pounds. My weight and my stomach hanging over my jeans was the first thing I thought about in the morning and the last thing I fretted about at night. Was I a fruitful Christian back then? I believe so, but I wasn't nearly as fruitful as I could have been because I was so imprisoned and distracted by my own physical imbalance. My mind also recalls a time when I was spiritually out of whack. I'd committed to too many things, and I'm quite sure I did few of them well. I wince when I think of how I whipped out the door with my jacket hanging by one sleeve and my arms wrapped around my purse, my Bible, and my planner. My keys were in my mouth, and I yelled through pursed lips, "Dinner is in the oven." I imagine my new neighbor walking by in fascination and wondering, "Wow, who's that gal? I want what she has." Not. Through painful circumstances beyond my control, as well as messes I've made for myself, I have finally found a form of balance that works even when life doesn't. Through pressing into the Lord during times of testing, I learned a profound concept. I pray I can communicate it in a way you can quickly take hold of and apply. Encarta Dictionary defines balance this way: a state in which various elements form a satisfying and harmonious whole, and nothing is out of proportion and unduly emphasized at the expense of the rest. Now that we have put away the notion that the balanced woman is one who keeps it together at all times, we can examine the true components of balance. The true components of balance. Everyone's life involves these three components to some degree. I will interchange each of these three terms throughout the book. 1. Input, or nourishment. 2. Output, or response. 3. Rest, or replenishment. When we overemphasize either input or output at the expense of the other, we have imbalance. Let's look at these three components as the three levers in life. As long as you live, you will need to receive nourishment so you won't become malnourished. And to remain healthy, you'll need to respond to what's being deposited in you. And finally, you'll need consistent rest from your labors, both physically and spiritually, so your body, mind, and soul can heal. What will change through the varying seasons of life is the degree to which you do these things. When I was sick in bed, I couldn't even consider training to run a race. I could, however, work on range of motion with my joints so I wouldn't get arthritis. Though my output, when compared to a healthy person, seemed like a dismal failure, for me, it was how I maximized my potential. Applying myself to that small task took care of my joints, and now I can ride my road bike at a steady, fast pace and recover well afterward. As I mentioned earlier, part of holding your ground and gaining it is honestly assessing your circumstance and then finding the greatest place of fruitfulness amid it all. In every situation, there is the best way to nourish yourself, the best way to respond to what's been deposited in you, and the best way to be replenished. We wander away from balance when we neglect, forget, or think we don't need all three of these components in our lives. We can't eat a lot and never exercise. We can't exert ourselves constantly without food, and we cannot, must not, neglect our God-given times of rest. As we come to understand the components of balance, we will also come to grasp the fluidity of balance. In other words, these components will adjust to our seasons and circumstances of life. Throughout much of this book, we will look at our physical and spiritual nourishment input, our physical and spiritual exercise output, and our physical and spiritual replenishment rest. I'll offer tangible tips to help you hold your ground on the bad days and gain new ground on the good days. At first glance, one would think a book on balance should address how we juggle all our roles in life. To me, this is like managing symptoms. If we take a deeper look at what we allow into our lives and how we exert ourselves and react to life and how we are replenished, if we manage our lives at this level, we will get to the core of where we put our time and why. As we develop the mindset that God has great nourishment for us physically and spiritually, we will become more alive in Christ. We will go through our days with a sense of expectation, knowing He has things He wants to deposit in us. We will pause and really taste the food He has provided for us.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.